Look at all that money. Yeah, the money that they spent. Take another look now and take some time for him. I don't cut trees for paper, cause it hurts the environment. Stop deforestation, yeah, it's time for him. Oh, an acre of hemp makes 20 barrels of oil. No need for pesticides to poison all our soil. People got no food, they got no clothes, they got no rent. Well, right now it's time for hemp.
Thank you for taking time for hemp. I'm your host, Casper Leitch. You are listening to the live broadcast of Time for Hemp. Oh, that's right. We're no longer live. I keep forgetting we're dead. No, we're not dead. We are pre-recorded. And that way we have great quality programming so that if we have a sound problem, we can get it fixed and make it sound just groovy for you. You find this on Tumblr, SoundCloud, and, of course, iHeartRadio. Go to timeforhemp.com and share us with your friends. It is Wednesday, and on Wednesday, we like to celebrate all the amazing people that leap law enforcement against prohibition. It's an amazing group of people. I would encourage you to go to leap.cc and find a speaker to bring to your neck of the woods to help people realize how important it is to end prohibition. And don't forget, anytime you hear the word joint on the big broadcast, nearly 2.5 million people all around the world pack their bongs, their pipes, their vaporizers, and twist up a joint and smoke their joints while we have a joint chat with our joint guests and our joint friends here on the big joint broadcast at Time for Hemp. And with that said, I'm going to pass this joint chat to my joint host, and he's going to bring on our joint friend while I smoke this joint here at Time for Hemp. Your Honor.
Thank you. Lenny Frieling, good morning to all. If you hear me breathing hard, sadly, it is not me smoking a joint during the show. It's just too confusing for me. And it's because I have literally come running from the courtroom, and that and the show gets me so excited that I breathe hard. So every once in a while, Casper has to hit me with a microphone and say, stop breathing, stop breathing. And then I turn red and get back to breathing. We have a very exciting guest with us today. We have James Doherty, Doherty, who is a leap.cc, law enforcement against prohibition speaker, with a significant background. He has seen the legal system from all the sides you can see it from. Good morning, James. How are you?
I'm doing fine. It's a pleasure to be here with you this morning.
Could you please give us the highlights of how you have spent your legal career, which I understand is over 30 years now?
Yeah. Well, actually, my first job was actually writing pre-sentence reports for judges and interviewing defendants and getting them into drug and alcohol treatment programs as an alternative to incarceration. And this was back in 1972. Prior to all of the mandatory sentencing coming in, when it used to be possible for a judge to put someone on probation to give them a chance to work on addiction problems that they had. But anyway, after that, I spent a year as a corrections officer for Multnomah County. That's Portland, Oregon. And then following that, I went to law school. After law school, I spent 3 years as a public defender. I was in private practice for a short time, and then I became a prosecutor and did that for several years in the territory, actually, of American Samoa. Then I came back to the States, and I became a municipal court prosecutor for 4 or 5 years for two different cities in the state of Washington. I have been on both sides, many sides of the fence here.
Many sides, including your obvious indirect statement of just how bright you are, because working in Samoa, every time I hear of a friend that has moved to the Attorney General's office in Samoa, I am just so impressed by how smart that is. Is it as wonderful as we would like to think?
It's a unique place. It's a small bar association.
It is wonderful to have a working in an office sort of across the road from the beach and the harbor. It was a unique space. But you know what was one of the unique things there? Our problem down there with substances was alcohol. You know, it's a hot climate, and a light Pilsner beer is great. But we had people that drank a bit too much. And that was actually the substance that we worked with a lot. While I was down there, I know that there was some marijuana being grown up in the jungle, but it stayed up in the jungle, and we actually didn't prosecute any marijuana cases while I was there. What we were trying to get a handle on, which was the big problem, was alcohol.
Never had a stoned person take a swing at you?
You know, the villages are very conservative, and I think many issues and many minor criminal offenses that in the states would come to court were handled in the villages by the chiefs there. And I think that they probably put the word out to the young men, particularly that they certainly couldn't smoke any marijuana in the villages. So if they did it, they did it up on the hillsides, up in the jungle. It's actually fairly conservative and certainly a very, very religious community. And they took a negative view of it, but fortunately it didn't get into being a legal problem, certainly as is caused all the problems here in the United States.
It sounds like it was a balance with manners and a police department that thought they had better things to do. Is that a fair assessment?
I think it's a very good assessment. I think the cops didn't go up into the jungle to bother the guys that went up there to smoke. So I think it was a good balance. While I was down there, there was just no discussion at all about marijuana. I know there were some people that smoked marijuana. In fact, I was at a Halloween party one time where in the middle of the Halloween party, and this was a lot of people that were on contract workers from the United States down there. There were a lot of doctors and lawyers and technical people, engineers, finance people that got jobs down in Samoa. But I was at a party and someone pulled out a joint. And it was illegal down there. And I thought it was, and they knew I was the prosecutor. I just sort of stood up and walked out. I thought it put me in sort of a compromising position while I was the prosecutor. But anyway, we had no marijuana prosecutions at all while I was down there. And no policeman ever brought anybody in.
Might I respectfully suggest that because it was Halloween, you may have been looking at something disguised as a joint, wearing a joint costume? It may have been a prank on you. And of course, you did you did the right thing. You do what you're going to do. I don't need to be here. Yeah. And in your position, I think certainly an appropriate reaction to it. Let me, with your involvement in Washington State, may I assume that you and our friend Roger Goodman know each other and have crossed paths?
Oh, yeah. I've known Roger for 10 or 12 years. We worked on the King County Bar Association drug policy project. And Roger headed that up, and that's how I got involved with LEAP, because he invited, why is my name blank? primary speaker with Leitch.
Peter Crist or
not? No.
I can picture him. He's the big beard.
That's all right. Anyway. I heard the lead speaker and said, Dad, I got to get involved in this. So I started working with Roger and the other people out here. And one of the other people in that project was Allison Holcomb, who ended up being the person that drafted the I-502 initiative which was enacted.
That's why I know the name.
Yeah. So it was a good group. And the King County Bar Association took the lead out here in getting together with doctors and lawyers and some church leaders and politicians in really taking a look at our drug policies. And I think it was very influential and it was very helpful when it came time for voting on I-502, because a lot of people had thought about the issues, had heard a lot of presentations about the issues. So I think we were a little ahead of the curve.
Is it fair to say, and as I think you know, I am a LEAP speaker also, have you experienced what I have, which is regardless of the title of the group, whether it's Rotary, whether it's County Republicans, whatever it is, have you been finding in general that they're listening, they're receptive, they're not goose step locked into their beliefs?
Oh, yeah. I think even from the beginning, people would all of a sudden start connecting the dots and realize, boy, this makes a lot of sense. Just as I was impacted when I heard my first LEAP speaker. And I think certainly over the last few years now, it's become much easier as a lot of the arguments that LEAP I think pioneered, they've become more mainstay, you know, particularly even with conservative people, the waste of funds and taxpayer money on the war on drugs. So it resonates with lots of different people for different reasons, but, it's an easy presentation to make, and people appreciate hearing it from someone that has some experience with law enforcement in courts.
I think the message coming from somebody who's been a Leo, who's been a law enforcement officer on the street, dealing with people in various states of consciousness, to me, even as a fellow LEAP speaker, to me, that really carries weight. I hear about things after the fact. The bruises may still be there, but everyone's sobered up and trying to behave nicely. They're trying to be nice to me. They're trying to be nice to the judge, much more so than in civil court. And I know that, I suspect, that's not what one sees on the street while things are live, hot, and happening.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of chaos out on the streets, and I think that particularly with the presentations that LEAP makes to groups like Rotary and Kiwanis and groups like that, for a lot of those people, they haven't really had the opportunity to sit down and talk these issues over with people who have dealt professionally with the issues in the courts and on the streets. So I think as a group, it's very easy to get the audience in a good mood. In sense of being open to the message.
I like the fact that it is such a strong Republican issue, self-determination, fiscal responsibility, states' rights, small government, and on and on. It's a Democratic issue, as it has been for years, and for a change, especially at times as a criminal defense attorney, and as you know, for a change. We have the logic and the facts on our side, as opposed to the law and the facts always on the prosecution side. So I think that gives us a good opening. And I think I can tell from the way you come across and the way I try to, we're not confrontive. We're not arguing. We're just laying out stuff for people to be able to think about. And I believe we're both saying they think about it.
Yeah. And, you know, one of the things that I think gradually over the years, people are becoming more open to the lifestyles of others. You know, I think it's symptomatic of change, differences in people being more open to the gay and lesbian community and realizing that people do lead very different lives. And just because they do, we don't need to condemn them. And that those people that do have an overuse or abuse of drug problems, you know, they've got a medical problem, they've got a social problem, and they need some assistance. And certainly locking somebody up doesn't solve the problem. And people are realizing the similarities of the drug issue with alcohol, which, of course, is obviously a drug. And as more and more recent studies are coming out, you know, alcohol is a more serious problem for health and for criminal conduct. And we've learned to deal with alcohol. It's never easy. But we're going to have to learn to work with drugs, different classes of drugs, in different ways, but in a treatment modality where that's necessary.
I'm reflecting back on the emotional attack that has succeeded in keeping prohibition going on marijuana and on other drugs. In 1937, with William Randolph Hearst's help, and Casper's probably thinks I'm a broken record on this, his emotional appeal, his work with Anslinger was so emotionally effective that he got the United States to prohibit making rope. Rope. Not for any reason except the emotions. The emotions are so strong that historically, as much as the as strong and prevalent as the hostility and evil directed towards our gay brothers and sisters, as extreme as that has been, it became okay to be gay before it became okay to be a pot smoker. Just to put it in an emotional perspective.
Well, a lot of that has to do with the fact that the gay community got more active. See, we have a real problem with the marijuana community. And that is you can't get them to turn out. Half of the people are afraid that they're going to be put on a list, or they're going to be seen on TV and lose their job, or they're going to be seen in a crowd and they're going to be followed by the police. The other half, I don't understand. It's like you'll approach somebody and say, can you give $20 to help Normal or to help Leap? And they'll say, I'd love to, brother, but I just spent $80 on a quarter ounce that my friends and I are going to smoke tonight at a concert. So they just don't care. And you try to get people to turn out to a march. The ones that don't care don't show up. The ones that are afraid don't show up. Then you got the growers that know that if it becomes legal, their fat paychecks are going to become teeny little things, because when the black market's gone, the prices that are artificially inflated are going to disappear. So they don't show up. So the only people that really show up are the choir, the people who are making all the noise, the hardworking activists, the very sick patients, the doctors, and the lawyers that Leap. The ones that need to show up either don't have the balls or don't have the or have the interest.
When I first signed, go ahead, please, James.
Go ahead, Casper.
No, go ahead, James.
Well, I was going to say, I think that the negative implication of being a marijuana user, I see it gradually lessening here in Washington. But even here, it's taking time for people to get used to marijuana. And we're certainly battling it out. A lot of cities are still prohibiting the retailers or producers of marijuana. And it's a gradual shift. But I still think people... A lot of professional people are don't want to be seen as a marijuana user. I think it's going to take a while. You don't want to go out and they'll, you know, be at a restaurant and order wine or drink scotch. And but still there's that distinction that people make for no valid medical reason that marijuana is not accepted in society. So it's going to take some time, even as states progressively start approving marijuana. It's going to take a time to erode that mindset that's been drilled into so many people for so long that marijuana is a dangerous substance, and people don't want to smoke it because, oh, if my kids see that I'm smoking marijuana, that'll be a bad influence on them. And whereas, you know, they sit around and drink a beer or have a drink, and don't think anything of it if their kids see them having a glass of wine.
Well, I know they also think that marijuana users do not pay their bills, and that's not true, because we're going to pay our bills right now. And then we're going to listen to a song about how fantastic marijuana is. And then we're going to come back and pick up where we left off here at Time for Hemp. You are listening to the Time for Hemp Global Broadcasting Network. Please share us with your friends.
THCF Medical Clinics are the premier physician's clinic in the United States. THCF has offices all across the United States from Hawaii to Michigan. THCF Medical Clinics has helped approximately 150,000 patients obtain their medical marijuana permits to legally possess, grow, and use medical marijuana. If you have chronic pain, multiple sclerosis, or any other neurological degenerative disease, or if you have any gastrointestinal disorders such as GERD, irritable bowel syndrome, or if you have AIDS, cancer, spastic disorders, seizure disorders, or glaucoma, call us at 1-800-723-0188 or visit us online at hemp.org. Again, the number is 1-800-723-0188 and the site is hemp.org.
And them one fake comment, but I try to. When me reason with me brethren, we smoke the herb, break it up and twist it up again. That's another thing that we do. But the Babylon, them one fake comment, but I try to.
Reason with me, brethren, we smoke. smoke the herb, break it up and twist it up again. And that's another thing that we do. But the Babylon, them one fake comment, but it's right through. When me reason with me brethren, we smoke the herb, break it up and twist it up again. And that's another thing that we do. But the Babylon, them one fake comment, but it's right through.
From 400 pounds that gets taken from the docks to 200 of them missing from police blocks. What a crap, can't get more political than that. Can't find no weed, they go dry, it's the same. But the crack and cocaine that's always down the lane. Kill my people slow, they don't know which way to go. And it's time they make this turn around. Tenth revolution, the system they did burn down to the ground.
Hold me reason with me, virgin. We smoke the herb, break it up and twist it up again. And that's another thing that we do. But the Babylon, them one fake comment, but it's right true. When me reason with me, virgin. We smoke the herb, break it up and twist it up again. Break it up and twist it up again. Twist it up again. Break it up and twist it up again. Twist it up again. Break it up and twist it up again. Break it up and twist it up again.
That was Michael Ericott doing Natural Ting, and it is a natural ting to be able to roll up a nice, healthy cigarette. And that's what marijuana is. Cannabis is, I don't care what you want to call it. You know, there are people who go, oh, I'm sorry, brother, I'm not in the hemp movement. I am in the medical marijuana movement. And then there are people who say, you know, I'm not in the medical marijuana movement. I'm in the hemp movement or whatever. Here's the deal. I don't care what you call it, cannabis, if you call it marijuana, if you call it hemp, if you call it ganja, whatever you call it, it's illegal. And until it becomes legal, your little pissing contest on what you're going to call it's kind of a moot point. With that said, I'm going to pass this to my joint host and my joint guest here in the big joint broadcast at Time for Hemp. Your Honor?
Thank you, Casper. I'm just observing every time I hear reggae along with our show, A, I love it, and B, even though I've been playing guitar since 1963, I must not be smoking enough because damned if I just can't play it. I can't get the rhythm right. It seems like it should be simple. I know the less you play and the fewer chords you play, the closer you're getting. But, oh, man, I have so much respect for something that looks so easy, sounds so simple, until you try to do it.
Right.
Kind of like a Beatles song, I guess. James, I understand that part of your law enforcement involvement was working in a jail. What were you doing in jail, James?
I was doing my time as a corrections officer. Generally, it was a large county jail. We had generally around 300 inmates, so not small. And I generally worked, sometimes worked the maximum security cell blocks and sometimes the minimum security for the trustees in the jail that worked in the kitchen and did the other chores. So I moved around different positions, but I was always in the cell blocks.
I have two questions I'm going to ask at the same time, so pick the one you like. One question is, did you see what you thought were, for people that wanted drug treatment, available programs that were at least half decently thought out? And the related question is, in a not a terribly large jail with 300, I mean, a lot of people, we're supposed to have 300 in Boulder County, we have 500. But the question is, were there drugs in jail, in a jail of that size that you were experiencing?
Yeah, well, yeah, I'd like to address both questions. The first one I can address pretty quickly. We had no treatment programs whatsoever in the jail. As with a lot of county jails and smaller facilities, this was back in the 1970s, there was almost nothing there. I mean, we had an outside exercise yard, but they couldn't go out when the ground was all soaked and wet, which was, you know, 10 months out of the year in Portland. It was kind of a swampy area. So the guys got almost no exercise. They had no drug treatment. You know, there was a small cart of books that would be rolled around every, you know, once a week it would come through the cell block. So, no, we didn't have anything that would provide any help to people using drugs who wanted to sort of work on their addictions. But as with most jails, we did have drugs that got in. And, of course, we were never quite sure how they got in, because if we knew how they were coming in, you know, we would have stopped it. But there's 1,000 different techniques, and inmates sitting around with lots of time to think, they come up with one way or another, and they find a way to get some stuff in. I don't think they got a lot in, but they got stuff in, and of course, it often led to problems, because sometimes it'd be some hard drugs, and some people wanted it, and there'd be fights over it, and it would cause problems.
This reminds me.
Go ahead.
This reminds me briefly.
I don't know that we had anybody smoking marijuana. I don't know that we ever had the smell of marijuana. I think people were trying to get in other drugs that they could snort. I think that was probably more common because we were just too packed in that the smell would have been noticed. But anyway. What were you saying, Casper?
I have frequent Lenny here. I have frequently said that smoking pot doesn't make people stupid, but some stupid people smoke pot. I read of a young man this morning, hot off the presses, young man busted, delivered a cardboard box packed for shipping, written on the box, "No drugs in this box."
You know, when I was a public defender, we used to get together every once in a while with the prosecutors. This was in a small town, and we'd talk about who did the dumbest thing in public during the past week, because there were always some people that you just think they didn't have their head screwed on straight one bit when they got in trouble. That sometimes it was because they were drinking or smoking some dope and mixing it with some alcohol or other substances. But it is amazing the conduct that some people get involved in and where they do it, where they're bound to be caught.
I have to say this now. I like to think I'm not a dumb guy, and I like to think smoking pot doesn't make me dumb. But I do believe that I am going to briefly share my story of perhaps the dumbest place that I personally have ever smoked pot or that I know of anyone else ever having done it. Short version, in another state. Leaving, going to the airport, last joint, had to be smoked before I got to the airport, parked in the driveway back corner to meet the people I just performed, just married them, parked in the far corner, figured I'll walk slowly to the front of this diner, I'll be done with the joint by then, life's good, no, nothing left, perfect, right? Good plan. Parked in the back of the parking lot, got up to the road, had about half the joint smoked, and looked up and realized two things at the same time. I realized I'd pulled into the wrong drive, and that, in fact, the diner was the drive 10 feet further down the road. And I also saw the sign labeling the drive and building that I'd pulled into as being Homeland Security.
Oh, cool.
So I did what any smart moron would do. I immediately, slowly and calmly walked back towards my rental car while finishing the other half of the joint. I mean, there's no half busted,
Right.
And boy, did I drive out of that driveway slowly. And to their credit, they should have noticed some guy leave a SUV in the far corner of a Homeland Security parking lot. They should have noticed what I was doing. And as I drove out, there was an armed guy just watching me. On the other hand, if you were Homeland Security, other than for pizza or donut delivery, why would you put a big sign at the front that says Homeland Security? So,
yeah.
As far as who's smoking what where, let me ask you this. We know that the consumption, the voluntary adult consumption of substances is illegal most places in the world, most places in the United States, and therefore that's a crime. We say it's a victimless crime. What I want to ask about, and you've seen this from so many sides, should we also be noticing what I call secondary crime, people, the crimes that are real crime that would not occur but for the illegality of the substances? Did that make sense?
Well, what are you referring to specifically?
I'm referring to things like street robbery, so that strong-armed robbery, so somebody can get money to buy drugs, burglaries, turf warfare, thefts, all of these real crimes. Is that something that, you know, I think it's a softball. Is that something that you are seeing from all of the angles you've gotten to see this from?
Oh, yeah. You know, it's the prohibition of the substance that creates all the negative effects on our society, which is what has perpetuated this idea that marijuana is a dangerous substance. But as you're so very aware, it's the making of it illegal that causes all of this ripple effect of all of the other related crimes. And indeed, a lot of people who are in custody, they may have used drugs, but they got into their criminal situation because of what they had to do to obtain the drugs. And it just snowballs all over the place. And that's the sort of the climate that our country has had in dealing with drugs. They point to all the other ancillary impact of prohibition and just forget to look at the fact that if you got rid of prohibition, you would get rid of a lot of the other criminal conduct.
So to repeat what you are saying, using almost the same words, the problem is not the drugs. The problem is the prohibition.
Exactly.
So if we address the drugs as a health problem, we're back to the leap, say, that I say so many times. Casper, I apologize for you having to hear it again, but it is so true. You can cure an addiction. You can't cure a conviction. Let me ask this. The officers on the street, the Leos in the trenches, did they all agree in prohibition, with prohibition? Did they all agree that absolutely these terrible drugs, marijuana, I don't care, should all be illegal? Was that universally held position?
Certainly not. I think probably there's a bit of variation between, you know, people in small rural communities and in the larger cities, but I think it varies a lot across the country in different places. But I think there are a lot of people in the legal system, whether they're judges or lawyers or law enforcement officers on the street. There's certainly a lot of them that realize that this is all just a big waste of time. It's a big charade that we're playing, but it's the law and it's the game, and we've all got our roles to play. But I think that certainly, you know, among the lawyers and judges, I think a lot of them got involved in trying to work towards ending prohibition because they were just seeing how the courts were getting clogged up. And it was hard to get cases moving properly when they had so many drug cases stacked up that weren't really accomplishing anything.
Well, as you know from being on all sides of this thing, from judge to prosecutor to defense attorney, as you know, drug cases, much of the time in state court, hinge on the pretrial motions hearing, where we argue constitutionality of searches and the rest. And they are unbelievably time-consuming for the court, for the witnesses, for the lawyers. And if you win the suppression hearing, if you win enough of it, the case is going to settle. If you lose the whole thing, frequently there aren't any trial issues left, but we have this huge incentive for defense attorneys to file every motion they can think of. And if a motion hearing can take 3 days, that's heaven. That's heaven. That's as good as it gets.
Go ahead.
Have you run into the changes in clearance rates on what we're calling real crime, homicides and the like, as the drug war is geared up?
Well, it's certainly the clearance rates on a lot of the serious crimes like murders decreased as police officers got sidetracked onto the drug cases. It take up a lot of time, even just filling out a basic report on a simple possession case takes an officer off the street and it just means they're not available to deal with the real serious issues going on.
I've heard stories of officers, and look, let's be really clear. I know damn well that virtually every Leo on the street is a really good person, honestly trying to do the right thing, and I have tremendous respect for them. And I'd be scared crapless to do what they do, and they do it. And we also know there's a percentage who are problems, who would be a problem in probably any line of work. But here's where I'm going with that. I have heard stories of, say, the problem, the small percentage, where they'll come up with a drug bust that may be a pretty easy bust to make right towards the end of their shift so they can get the 3 or 4 hours of overtime to write the thing up. Was that anything that you've been exposed to? Do you think that's reality?
I haven't been directly exposed to it, but I wouldn't doubt that it's true. I think that, the officer's always looking away to, make an easy buck if they got the time, and they certainly shouldn't be, looking for a way to pad their paycheck and put it on the backs of somebody with a possession charge. But yeah, I've heard that story. I suspect it's unfortunately true.
Well, here's something that is very, very unfortunately true. We need to take a commercial break and pay our bills. That's how we keep this program and network up and going. Please go to our website and click on the banners that you find there and let our sponsors know that you heard about them here on Time for Hemp. Network. Please share us with your friends. Yeah, stay alert with consciousness. Be responsible with what you do and who you do it with. We have been enjoying a fantastic joint conversation with my joint host and our joint guest today. And I'm going to pass this little chit-chat back to our joint party here at Time for Hemp.
Well, hopefully, as usual, I'm just smoking it, man. I'm just smoking it. But I can't do it during the show because that's not what works for me. One of the questions, I'd really like to thank our guest, James Doherty. He has such a unique background, having seen this thing from all directions. I've seen it from a couple. He's seen it from all directions. And unquestionably, he is telling us, prohibition doesn't work. It won't work. It will, and if I may put words in his mouth, it will never work. I can say that in the Boulder jail, Boulder County, Colorado, free state of Colorado, even with our 500 people and 300 inmates, there at least are programs. There are treatment programs. Are they effective? I don't know. 12-step works for some. They have others. I have a client in there now who created additional programs. He complained they didn't have a 12-step program on weekends. I said, put up a sign-up sheet, make one. He did. So it is not 100% as bleak as it sounds. On the other hand, I spoke to a couple at an international conference for drug policy reform in Albuquerque some years ago, and I asked these people, you've been in prison, you've been to the big house, you were sent down. Are drugs really as available in prison as TV and the movies would have us think? And the response was that they went in as heroin addicts and came out as cocaine addicts. James, is there anything that I can ask you so that we can let you go to the get to the rest of your responsibilities?
No, I think we covered a lot of good topics. I really have enjoyed the discussion. And there's always lots of war stories from those of us that have been working with marijuana over the years. And they're often very sad stories, you know, the interaction of the criminal laws and drug use. And it certainly would be better if these issues were handled. When people have a drug abuse problem, it should be handled medically. You know, if they've got social problems, perhaps get counseling. But certainly the criminal system is not a place to deal with the issues involving drugs. But I thank you for having me on the show. I've got to run right now.
Any URLs you want to put a spotlight on or organizations before you go?
No, just LEAP is a great organization. I think there are a number of other groups that certainly are working these issues. I think LEAP's got a good face and a good foot in the door in a lot of communities. And encourage the listeners to get a LEAP speaker, if at all possible, to address your community, not just to the people that agree with you. When you know there's a group that is struggling with trying to understand the drug issues, bring in a LEAP speaker and we'll help people work and think those things through.
Well, thank you for being part of the big joint broadcast today. We look forward to having you back as a guest sometime in the very near joint future.
Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Goodbye, James.
Goodbye. Your Honor, you have been very busy there in the state of Colorado. I am reading all kinds of groovy news that Colorado produced X amount of pounds of marijuana for sale and came up with X amount of millions of dollars in tax money and revenue. Is it raining money? Is it creating jobs? Is it the big bonanza that everybody believed it was going to be? Or is it far short?
It reminds me so much of the first Colorado gold rush that I explain it as the second Colorado gold rush. A lot of people panned gold. A few of them found it. A lot of people dug holes. A few of them found gold. Sears and Roebuck sold shovels. They're still around. Right. So are people making?
Gotcha.
And yes, yeah, some people are making a lot of money. Some people are losing a lot of money. It is such a shifting paradigm, such a shifting landscape, that what may be okay in one county one day, 2 days later, it's not. How do you deal with that in a business plan? Well, it's just like Las Vegas. Everyone can afford to put any amount of money on red and win. But if you can't afford to lose, you can't put your money on red. And I think the same thing is true here. There are brave souls out there. I love them. I respect them. I patronize them with a smile. I learn from them. Would I want to be going into the marijuana growing business? Frankly, no, no. My junk is not up to it, as they say.
Well, I know that there's been people who have said that they've packed everything up, left Indiana or Michigan or whatever, and they've gone racing to Colorado thinking that they were going to be able to, like, basically rent a small little place, grow a few little plants, and open up a shop. And they are amazingly surprised at the cost of licenses and camera security for the plants and hiring people who are trained by the state and all that. I mean, there's a lot more to just opening a dispensary than renting a place and growing plants in Colorado.
Yes, we see piles. We see piles of people who move here just so they can do what they've always done legally, smoke some pot. And we have people who interpret TV as saying, you can do anything you want, it's a free-for-all. And they come here and all of a sudden they realize, I can't get a location for which I can even apply for a license. The location is the single most difficult challenge if you're talking about a business. If you want to grow six plants at home, three flowering, you can do that. And there are some ongoing developing areas, and we're struggling with it. But the short answer is the Colorado Constitution, Article 18, Section 14. There we go. And Article 18, Section 16, medical and recreational. I can, if I choose, grow six plants in my house with three flowering. So at the end of the day, that to me is the saving clause for all the other complications. The more you get into the business end, the more you're into the location, the licensing, the ability of any governmental organization, county, city, to ban some, any, or all of the businesses. And with them shifting, changing their minds, I keep track of this stuff. And I think that since we have started our show today, the law has changed somewhere in Colorado, three times, three different places. It's already changed. I'll read it tonight.
Wow.
James was talking about, we have war stories. And the fact is, 38 years in courtrooms. Yeah, I do have some good war stories. The problem with this war is we call it, Richard Nixon named it, a war on drugs. And as we all know, the power of the word, and lawyers really know this, the power of the word is unbelievable. You have to cast the right spell at the right time. And that's a lot of what lawyering is. And Richard Nixon did that. The right spell was war on drugs. He did it at the right time. And people are first realizing that you can't go to war against a drug. You can go to war against people. And that's what we've done. And particularly, we've gone to war against people of darker colors than I am. We've disenfranchised people of color. We've taken their votes away, disenfranchised them. We have, in some places in the country, 25% of young black males are either felons under supervision of the court in some way or in some other way involved with the criminal legal system, much of which, perhaps most of which, is drug-based. Well, if we want to kill all the black people, let's be honest about it, the way they always are about the Jews, and say, we're just going to kill them all. And then maybe somebody hopefully stops them. Instead, it's done subtly. It's done with private prisons. It's done with stop and frisk, empty your pocket stuff in New York, which is hopefully winding down now. It's done nefariously. It's done with undercover officers who are paid to lie. Cops paid to lie. There's something wrong with that picture. And in fact, it makes total sense that the founding fathers of LEAP, I think all of them worked undercover. One of them was the head of the New Jersey State Police undercover narcotics unit for 14 years. The guy that we were the most afraid of when I grew up in New Jersey, him. He helped start LEAP. From the people that were honest people being paid to lie, cheat, and steal because that was their job, who are now looking back saying, that was bad. I did things that were not good, that did not help, that made the problem worse, that tried to extend a policy of prohibition. And my question to the late President Nixon is this: if it hasn't worked yet, will it work in 4 more years? Will it work in 8 more years? And the answer, as we all know, is no, prohibition will never work. Never has, never will. But what it does do is create a thriving cartel in Mexico and south of there, a thriving organized crime and less organized crime business, civilization beneath a civilization in the United States. People that are growing pot, risking prison, not paying taxes on the money, indirectly in ways creating street crime, creating crimes against the person, creating just the kind of crimes that we would look at and say, that's a crime. We want police out helping us with those issues. And guess what? Leo's law enforcement officers, for the most part, almost universally, that's really what they want to do. They really rather solve a rape than solve a cocaine problem.
Right on. Well, one thing we've got to solve is the hour. We are at the end of it, so it's time to give a shout out to your favorite organization and or URL before we wrap it up.
As we know, I love giving a shout out to SSDP and MPA and DPA and Normal and especially LEAP.cc. It is my opinion that the Constitution of the state of Colorado was amended only because these organizations worked together. They focused more on what they had in common, how they could cooperate, not how they could compete. And that's a very big statement because to exist, an organization, LEAP, Normal, needs money. They need you, our listeners. They need me. They need Casper to be sending them money. Personally, I send them all what I can. I don't pick one over the other because they're working together better than most groups work together. As Casper knows, I get paid $1 million a year to do this show with him, so this is not exactly charity. But the other 40 hours plus a week that's not billing time, lawyering time, is spent moving this forward. And I admit it. I am proud of the fact that living in the free state of Colorado, where I can go to the store and buy pot or hash, or I happen to like gummy bears, lock them up from the kids. And I think that if anything, I do more hours now. Now, the $1 million a year that I get to do this show, Casper, I'm keeping the signing bonus quiet because of our confidentiality agreement, so I'm not going to talk about that. And thank you again for having me.
Absolutely. And as always, we'll have you every Wednesday here on the Big Joint Podcast when we salute all the hardworking people at LEAP. And remember, the next time you hear me, you'll know that it's time for hemp.